Hey everyone, this is Carlos, founder and CEO at Product School. Today I'm here with Bela Stepanova, who is the VP of Product at Iterable, really cool company based out of San Francisco with team all over the world. Hey Bela.
Hi Carlos, great to see you. And hi everybody.
Thanks for being on the show. Can't wait to dive a little bit deeper into how you're thinking about product and how your own product is also kind of shaping the ecosystem. But let's start from the very beginning. I love to ask, how did you break into product?
Yeah, great question. As a kid, I loved math and was just obsessed with it. Never knew what could I do with it. And at some point when I think I was around 12, I found a book on Turbo Pascal, kind of dating myself here, but started reverse engineering all the different pieces of code, fell in love with it because it made something real out of logic, out of what I loved. It made something real that I could grasp and kind of see the outcome of. And so I fell in love with computer science. Since then, after college, I was a software engineer building fintech products. And I got exposure early on into working directly with customers and working directly with users. And I just absolutely fell in love with it, never looked back. I sort of asking customers why, multiple times, really getting to the root of the problem rather than starting with a solution and getting that kind of fulfillment almost from seeing your users, talking to your customers directly. That really turned me onto product. So I switched from software engineering into product and never looked back.
I love how you said why three times, because it's, you know, there's the first answer is probably not enough. And as a product people, they want to dig deeper.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I would say 10 times, right? Sometimes the problem is so complex that if you keep asking when, I think people also tend to have a bias towards telling you what they imagine the solution to be, because everybody loves to play a product manager and a designer in kind of this brainstorming session. And I think getting really to the root of the problem takes a little bit of extra investigation and a little bit of extra effort.
So one of the things I found unique in your profile is that you were a software engineer at Box, and then your next title was chief of staff to the SVP of product there. So tell me more about that.
Yeah, very interesting. For the first 2 years after college, I was in consulting, so I really focused on building products and spend a year building a product, releasing the product, optimizing the product, but then I would leave to the next product. And so that sense of ownership, I really wanted to own my products, right? Those were my babies. I wanted to continue to be with the products. And so I switched to Box. And at a time, because I was in consulting, I sort of was used to working within the Scrum team, but I didn't really know how the larger engineering organization or larger product organization works. So I actually went back to my engineering roots at Box, and it was sort of early on. So it was multiple hats, sort of program management, sort of operations job. And I wanted to learn how does engineering function as an organization. I wanted to get that big eye view across the board, because I felt like that's a skill set that I was missing in order to be successful longer term in my career. So I did that for a year, very naturally started doing product work. It's just because that's what I tend to lean in, that's what I love. And I ended up building out product roadmaps for the teams that didn't have roadmaps at a time, or didn't have business roadmaps at a time, mostly focused on technology, which were our backend teams. And I approached our SVP of product at a time, our CPO, and said, hey, there's all these teams that don't have technical product management today. We have so much business value there. Why don't we think about technical product management? And by the way, here's a roadmap. Here's how I would think about it. And I'd love to volunteer for that. And instead, he said, that's great. We definitely need to do that. I have a bigger problem right now. Why don't you come solve that for me? And that's how I ended up in a chief of staff role. So it was a little bit of a fun zigzag, but really focusing on what do I want to learn and what the skill sets that I want to learn versus sort of a how do I progress to that next level as a product manager.
I think that's really powerful, because we get approached by a lot of people who come to us and, hey, how do I become a product manager, right? And they have this expectation of like, I need the product manager title on my resume. And I've seen people that are willing just to raise their hand and offer help, right, and try. And that would probably lead to a better outcome in the future. But just trying to approach this with like, how can I help instead of what can you give me? It's really powerful.
And then what skill set can you build, right? A lot of times in internal mobility, I've seen a lot of folks transfer over the years to the product team. And a lot of times it started with As we all know, we'll run really fast, especially in the smallest startups and highly growth, scalable startups. And, you know, there's a lot of need always, right? And product managers can't solve it all. There's always that next project we haven't specced yet, haven't researched yet. So there's always need for help. And I've seen a lot of people transfer successfully to the product teams when they raise their hand and say, hey, I will do this extra work. And I will sort of be mentored by somebody and play the product manager role to help the product team now without the title, without the transfer. And that really builds the skill set, the relationship. And I think raising your hand to help is always a great, great way to create opportunities for yourself.
As a fun fact, we've had multiple product leaders from Box on the show, and Jeetu Patel was a former CPO. Not sure if that was the person who was working with you, and also Varun, who's an SVP of product. Like, I've seen a lot of really good product leaders coming out of Box.
Thank you. Yeah, they're wonderful. I worked with both of them. I started just before Jeetu, so my earliest story for the chief of staff was for the previous CPO, Chris Ye. But Jeetu and Varun are also wonderful. Loved working with both of them. They're still closely in touch.
So now moving forward, you're a Miss VP of product at Iterable, that for people who don't know, it's a rocket ship. So why don't you tell us a little bit more about the status of the company?
Yeah, absolutely. We are a high-growth startup. We are about 400 people now. We're growing really, really fast. I think we've hired a lot of people through COVID, and the company just over the last year grown tremendously. Our product team has grown from 7 to, I'm losing count, I think we're now about 25 people. So been a lot of fun, been a really fun journey. For those who don't know what we do today, we power marketing lifecycle automation and also transactional messages. So really thinking about unifying that consumer experience and how companies talk to consumers and that brand experience that they have. So been really, really fun. And yeah, welcome everybody to have a look. I think especially for the product managers directly, I know in the past I have built transactional messages from scratch and having to go to engineering to A/B test messages all the time without sort of having the full control. That's something product managers have definitely used us in their collaboration with marketing of our product.
It resonates with the problem about, you mentioned about trying to create the infrastructure to message users, because we come from a world where pretty much everything was an email, and then there are different ways of communicating, omni-channel, right? Like in-app notifications, push notifications, some text messaging, social media, so many. And back in the day, there wasn't really a plug-and-play solution. So as a PM, I would need to go talk to my engineers and be like, hey, can you custom build a push notification in this moment? And now we're in a whole new world where someone who's not technical can really customize the entire user journey and when to approach customers and create a complicated logic without really involving engineers.
Yeah, and what's really interesting about it, it's not just the engineering effort that you save, but also how smart you can get, how much you can test the journey, right? But one of the things that was really hard in infrastructure, for example, I built a growth team at Box, and one of the things that we've had really hard time with in terms of when to communicate to users and close those growth loops was targeting. Targeting based on, a lot of times for products, you have all the behavior data going into the data warehouse and you can't access that real time, right? How do you target somebody in the right time to deliver the right value? And so being able to, for business users to actually use sophisticated segmentation and being able to really customize that journey, as you said, right? Not just the individual messages, is really, really big power. And obviously on top of that, to A/B test the content and the timing and the targeting, all without having to go back to engineers and sacrifice other things on your roadmap.
So how do you see product managers in particular interacting with marketers and engineers and other functions in order to deliver those type of experiences?
Yeah, it's interesting. You know, it still, I would say, varies from organization to organization that I see. A lot of times that interaction and that collaboration sparks within mobile. Because a lot of times mobile, obviously, you still have to incorporate SDKs. And it used to be that mostly mobile engineers are doing the mobile messaging. So I see a lot of the sort of spark for the better collaboration, the tighter collaboration start with mobile efforts. And then the big intersection that I also see now is on a transactional messaging side, right? It's an opportunity for an upsell. It's an opportunity to make sure the brand is displayed in the right way. It's an opportunity to actually understand and incorporate and unify the journey and the experiences that your users of your products have. So those are kind of the couple of functional areas where I see marketers and product managers collaborate more and more.
That's really cool. And I agree with you. I think this is not yet, this is a team sport at the end of the day. And there was a time where data was literally guarded by data team. And now that not just data teams, but like anybody, marketers, PMs can understand what's going on. And without really running CQL, just have a sneak peek about really what's happening and then kind of run their own experiments. That just makes them, the whole organization, more self-sufficient, more agile at the end of the day.
Absolutely. And if you think about it from an organization, and it's just more fun to work together, it's great. But then if you think about your own customer experience, right, it's not really fun for anybody to interact with one department or part of product in one way, but a different department in a different way, right? When we think about when we experience in products, this is those physical products or software products, we kind of think of a brand as one. Right. So if you can tell when you interact with different departments differently, or if like, hey, marketing is not working well with product, you can really tell on the experience that the brand or the products provide. And that's not great, right, for our customers, which I think is actually very interesting too, even with product organizations, how the product organizations are structured. Sometimes you can literally see that on the website, on the apps, on the products, if they're not coordinating well.
Yeah, let's double click on that, because I understand there are different companies using different models, but like, how do you go about building your own product team?
Yeah, I mean, there's tons and tons to cover that. I think we could talk a little bit about organizational design. We could talk a little bit about people. Maybe starting with the people aspect, because at the end of the day, I think the right people are everything on a team, right? And ultimately define the success. When hiring, I always think of my team as sort of puzzle pieces, individual puzzle pieces. So how do you make sure the puzzle pieces are really coming together, that together as a team are set up for success and are very strong? And so I think about the skill sets, I think about the superpowers and talents, and how do you make sure they're all complementary, right? So that together we're really, really strong and can build the best product. I think organizationally, there's always an interesting question of how do you build organization in a way, especially if you have many scrum teams at some point, right, and the company has grown a lot, how do you do that so you make sure that your strategy, you're doing the right things, the most important things, so that you can still focus and your strategy is not just sort of optimized for that local maxima for each scrum team. And so making sure that you structure it in a way that you have enough kind of thought and enough coverage where folks are thinking across the board, as well as the deeply in individual pieces as well.
So are there any specific insights that you can share in terms of like ratio PM per engineer, or like, and I've seen companies say, oh, we have a two pizza team. And
It really depends on the type of team, right? Because some teams and the product that you're building, some products are a little bit more technical. Some products have a lot more sort of that sort of UI real estate, right? So it really just depends on the product. I would say in general, what I've seen work well is somewhere between 6 to 9 engineers on a scrum team. A scrum team, typically some scrum team, maybe if it's an infrastructure scrum team for a particular product, might not need a PM. Majority of the other scrum teams likely to need a PM. So that's kind of the ratio of engineers to PM. Again, there's no like a rule of thumb that works for everybody, but I think it's a good starting point to consider. Again, depending on the product, if you do have a lot of sort of the user experience and complex user experience, I love the idea of the 1-to-1 of a PM to a designer. Again, maybe if it's a little bit more technical, maybe you don't need as many designers. There are also designers that are slightly different that focus on, for example, developer experience and even API design, right? And it's a slightly different role. The one thing I would say about designers and PMs, I've seen companies, and maybe that's a little bit of a personal pet peeve of mine, where a design team grows really fast and then product management team grows slower or all the way around. And it creates like a funky cultural experience, right? There's a little bit of throwing things over the border where the teams don't feel quite functioning as one. So I love the idea of, for whatever makes sense for your product in terms of ratios, growing both designers and product managers at the same time through the team, so that there's really that sense of one team, because at the end of the day, we're building one product.
Totally. And I think it's important to clarify that the product team is not yet made up of product managers. You mentioned designers, engineers, like we are all building this together.
Yeah, that's a great point. For example, in my product team right now, we have multiple roles. We have product managers, we have designers, we have technical writers, and technical writers overlook documentation as well as UX copy. Sometimes UX copy could be a slightly different role as well. But for us, that's what it does. And then we have product operations. And then we also recently added partner managers. So thinking through the product, right, as we think through all of the product decisions of build, buy, or partner, we're actually really closely working now as partner managers as well. And that encompasses the whole product team.
So obviously now your company, you have multiple products, there are multiple product teams. So as the VP of product, how do you try to create the alignment across the entire product organization?
Yeah, it's a great question. What's actually, I think, even more interesting is that as a product leader, or even every individual product managers, I think a lot of times we're looked to create alignment across the entire organization and not just a product organization. Because at the end of the day, if you look at, for example, in B2B products, right, we have customer success, we have sales, and everybody depends on the product that we build, and everybody has input onto the product that we build as well. So really thinking through how do we make sure that we're aligned at the highest level, so the vision for the product and where the company is going, that we are aligned on the go-to-market strategy with the company as well, and making sure that everybody within the product organization is aligned on those aspects too. And then double-clicking of, well, what is the focus, right? Where are we going to focus this year? What sort of problems do we want to solve? Not just what features we want to build, right? What problems do we want to solve? Why are those problems the most important? Why? How would we be different in those particular set of problems from everybody else in the market? What is the best way to solve them? So kind of really thinking through that strategy, the vision, and making sure that we're aligned on the problem set. And then obviously, as we go along, there is a lot of structures and processes in place to align on the execution itself.
I just reminded one thing that the former CPO at Box, Jeetu Patel, said here, that alignment can be the enemy of innovation, and that really now he's at Cisco, and how he was trying to balance alignment with obviously moving forward and getting things done and making sure that we don't spend too much time in the meeting room.
Yeah, meetings are funny. That's probably like the enemy of everybody. How do you spend enough time? I think a lot of times, especially now with everybody being a little more distributed across like tech world in general, thinking through what can you do, I think, what can you do in person? But I think it's also really important, especially for product managers who tend to spend a lot of times in meetings, unlike probably other roles, thinking how do we create enough space to think? Right? How do we create enough space to think innovatively? How do we create enough space to think, to brainstorm, and not just get caught up in the execution itself? And I think that's sort of the forever challenge. Folks definitely try the different tactics, but that's definitely something to be aware of as a common trap, right? Not having enough time to think, and you just sort of execute what's happening. But in fact, the market is moving all around you. And over the last year and a half with COVID, the market's been moving so fast, especially in areas like ours.
Mm-hmm. I mean, if you think about it, PMs, by definition, they start as individual contributors. And if they take the managerial path that you took, at some point you start managing people, PMs and others. But we didn't go to school for that. I mean, maybe back in the day, but like things are changing fast. So I think like what I've heard from different product leaders is that you take the fish out of the water for too long, they also need to, you know, get it, be close enough to the action to realize that it's not just about alignment or meeting, it's also about building and talking with customers.
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, I don't think any leader should come out of the water of talking to customers at any point. I think something you asked me the other time was like, what do I do that's might be perceived as not scalable, but I still do every day. I think talking to customers, I still personally read every bit of NPS feedback that we get. I ask for calls, even if we don't have the supply scheduled for any deal that we lost or customer that's churned. I read every single sort of notification from Salesforce on what we won, what we lost, right? So really making sure whenever, especially specific customer language, I read that personally every day, jump on a lot of customer calls. I think some of those things, it's not just about people management, right? You're still responsible for the product and the success of the company. I think there is another aspect. There's a customer aspect on talking to customers at all time, reading directly to the users of the product, observing the users of the product. And then kind of depending, I guess, on the preferences and superpowers of each product leader. Like I, for example, still we have design reviews, right? And product concept reviews that we go put every product through.
And let's talk about the next generation of product leaders out there. I remember back in the day when there was this misconception around, well, you have to be an engineer or someone somewhat technical in order to work in product. Mm-hmm. While that might be true in some cases, we have seen incredible product leaders coming from so many different backgrounds, design, business, operations and you name it. So what is your personal take on, like, how do you actually hire PMs at Iterable?
Yeah, great question. And maybe I'll just comment on the computer science piece really quick. You know how I mentioned earlier that when I build a team, I kind of think of us as puzzle pieces. How do we all fit together to make the best puzzle possible? Like, in that vein, if you hire everybody from computer science degree, we're all going to think the same way. We're all going to be that same puzzle piece, right? So innovation and sort of creativity is going to be limited to that particular way of thinking. So I think it's absolutely wrong to hire everybody from computer science degree. At some point, also experience trumps the degree itself. So depending on the role, obviously some technical roles, maybe if you're building APIs in this case, you might need some a little bit more technical background. Background doesn't necessarily mean a degree from university. I've hired folks to be product managers from biology majors, and they've been fantastic at it, and they think slightly different, right? Everybody brings something different to the table, and I think especially in a role like a product manager, creativity really, really matters, as well as designer or any other product roles for that matter.
And I think having product role models like yourself that are really making an effort to hire a diverse pool of talented people is really inspiring, because like, we all need to understand that in order to represent the customer, especially when you're building something that global, you need to have some sort of representation in-house.
Yeah, exactly. And I think just generally, diversity of thought matters so much. And that comes from diversity of backgrounds, be those cultural, ethical, educational, right? There's just so many different aspects of diversity. And I think having more and more different types of thinking at the table is incredibly important.
Is there any key question that you like asking during the interview process?
Yeah, absolutely. There are a few that I always ask. One of them, and I actually ask that of other roles too, not just product managers, is in the very beginning with introductions, I always ask people, what would you like to learn next? And I don't mean that as like a hobby, or we generally that's more kind of career related as they tell their story. Because what I really want to understand is, what are they passionate about? What are they hungry for, right? What opportunities do they want to have? Because one of the things that I evaluate when I hire is not just, can you do the job, but will you enjoy the job? Will you be happy in the job? Is it ultimately going to be the right experience, the right environment for you to blossom? And if you're looking for different type of opportunities that maybe I cannot provide for you right now, then it might not be the right job, right, for you. So that's one of my favorite questions. I honestly ask that for different types of levels. And it's really, usually really telling what folks answer on that question.
So without meaning to put you on the spot, I want to turn this question back at you and ask you, what are you curious about learning these days?
Yeah, I mean, I can answer it more tactically, but also maybe if you turned it around to me as an interview type, the way that I asked, one of the things that I've been learning over the last couple of years, you know, especially coming into the head of product role, is how do you see further? I think the more and more you grow in your career, sort of your horizon starts expanding, right? In the product roles, a lot of times we'll talk about roadmaps or sets of problems. Maybe we'll see a year in. Maybe we'll have like a vision a couple of years in. But how do you create that sort of, put those glasses on, I guess, that allows you to see a bigger horizon, like 5 years down the road, 10 years down the road? How do you create that creativity, create that space, create the right sort of settings, I guess, for your mind to really think about it? And that's something I've been fascinated about. I love storytelling. I love kind of just blank canvas brainstorming. And that's something I've been personally practicing and learning from others as well over the last couple of years. That's been really exciting.
Well, thank you. I think you're hired.
Yes.
So
thank you, Carl.
One thing that it's also top of mind for me is like, okay, you have an incredible trajectory and it's different than many other VPs of product out there. So what would you say are some of those marks of great leadership or key moments that you think that help you get to where you are today?
Yeah, I think things that help me, first and foremost, probably curiosity. Like some of the roles that I've had in the past that I would say were some of the more door opening in terms of career, they weren't listed as roles. Like at Box, for example, I forget how many years ago, but I founded our growth team. At a time, sort of B2B growth has been a sort of early on topic. It was unclear if that's what really B2B companies want to do, or B2B2C, I guess, is more important. And that role was not on the table. That team was not on the table. And I made a business case for that team to be on the table and why it's important for our business and how to go about it and build out a team from there. And it actually helped me build a tremendous network because I have not done that before, even though I have proposed it. And in fact, I've proposed it to do that for the company independent of me. But I haven't done it before. And it also just reaching out to people and being curious and wanting to learn really actually opened up my network as well externally, because I just started asking for help. And I just started meeting with leaders who've done growth in B2C companies and a couple at a time that actually have had some experience in the B2B companies. And it was fantastic. Hey, I met tremendous people that I just absolutely love to this day. And they helped me in my career in general, but they also helped me in that role. So I think curiosity and the desire to grow and kind of having that self-awareness, and that's something I think all the leaders should constantly work on. I know I constantly work on self-awareness, knowing what I know, knowing what I don't know, where I need to push myself, where I need to reach out for help, definitely helped me along the way. I'd say probably another one, especially if folks are looking to work in the startup world, I call it sturdiness. And something I will look for in sort of interview process as well, really being able to go through, weather the changes, right, and seeing further out on the horizon and being able to face challenges in a way that you can process it, help others in a startup world, be that a high scale startup and kind of a later stage like Iterable or earlier stage, there's so much change all the time. Sometimes you need to pivot the strategy. Sometimes people leave it come and go, right? Sometimes things happen and things always change. And so being able to kind of enjoy that and ride with that change and also think about what's best for the business and own the problems as they come up rather than just sort of suffer for them being problems, I think is incredibly important. And I do think it helped me a lot through my career as well.
Well, so any final words of wisdom for like a younger you? There's a lot of people in the audience, they are entry to mid-level PMs that are thinking, great, I want to, I'm doing it, but I don't know if there is light at the end of the tunnel. I also don't know what the future of product is going to look like in, you know, 5 years from now. So what would you say to kind of your younger self when you were at Box?
Yeah, I would say that's okay not to know. That's part of the fun, right? It's okay to be nervous. That's also part of the fun. If you're not nervous, you're probably not doing something big enough and not giving yourself enough credit with big enough talent. I would say career is not a race. Career is what you, and it's not just titles. Titles matter by all means. I don't want to say they don't matter at all, but it's really about what you learn and the story that you create for yourself, right? The skill set that you build. And I think thinking about your career is not necessarily a race to that next title, but a race for opportunities, a race for learning, the hunger to learn, I think is incredibly important to maintain in a career. And choose the places, choose the environments where you can blossom. We all have very different superpowers. Find the places where you'll be supported. You'll have the right opportunities because there might be sometimes really lucrative places, but maybe they don't have the right opportunities based on what that individual wants to learn. And I think the environment in which you put yourself in your career has a lot to do with how successful you'll be in your career and whether you'll be able to blossom there. So I would really recommend really thinking through your career as something you own and as a interviews as a two-way street to find just the right place where you will blossom yourself and make sure it's right for you and not just the company and the resume.
That's a beautiful way to wrap up this interview. It's been a pleasure to chat and learn from you, Bela. Thank you for your time.
Thanks so much, Carlos. Thanks for having me.